Scott Killerman is painting and gaming today. You're taking a look at the final product of what is the gelatinous cube. And so we'll cut to the way it looks when you first start. As you can see, it's nothing but clear plastic. And actually the inside of it comes apart. We're going to start off pretty much, my thinking was using a wash, but we're going to do an ink wash. To that, we're going to add some water. We're going to use a cheap brush. And we're going to go to town on it. Now this first layer, as I started working, I realized bit too thick. Want to maintain some level of transparency. So I went ahead and put the centerpiece in. Yeah, I can't see through that. So that's going to be a problem, right? I left this in so you can see, you know, mistakes happen to all of us. Part of the process. So I went ahead, since it was still wet, hit with water, and just rubbed it off with a brush, wiped it with a paper towel. And yeah, we're going to go at it with part two. As we learned with that it was too thick. So I kind of went ahead and said, well, I'll try some glaze medium. We will thin it out, but not let it get too watery. So I poured quite a bit of glaze medium in there, as you see, mixed it around. And it seemed to be pretty fluid. I had some more water. Really trying to get this as a very, very thin wash. So right away, you can see I'm hitting it and it's a lot more translucent than it was before. So I'm letting that set so it'll dry. And I'm looking at the inside piece and thinking I'm going to go with yellow. So we're going to do the same thing that I did in the outside. I'm going to make it thin, put some water. Actually, with this, I didn't use any glaze medium because I wanted it to be thicker and I wanted it to cover. So not too much to be said about this other than make sure you get behind that piece as well. So now that one side of the cube is dry, I went ahead and tried to do all of the other sides that are remaining. And you can see how it's looking. It seems to be pretty good as it's wet. I like the intensity, the luminance, but yet we're still maintaining some transparency. So I let it dry a little bit. I came back. Now I'm putting on additional coats, hitting the inside again for a second time because it just wasn't dark enough. So one of the advantages to these Nolzur miniatures, well, before I get into that, take a look at what we got. This is the next day. It has dried and it looks really funky. You can see some areas where you can see through the cube. I actually rubbed that with my thumb. It's very, very cloudy. Didn't maintain its clarity and transparency. And you can see even closer here, I just did not like the way that it looked. Even if I cleared some areas. So I really thought, you know, I got to start over. I did something wrong. I hit it with alcohol and an old toothbrush and it wiped right off. You know, not a problem. So this time we're going to use gloss varnish. And this is a Liquitex product. I went ahead and threw the gloss varnish in and just a few drops of the green. Sorry for that moment of blackness. So yeah, a few drops of green here. I didn't want to hit with too much pigment because I felt that was also causing me an issue with the loss of transparency with my first attempt. Now, just so you know, this is the method that ended up working. I was happy with it. I wanted to leave my mistake in there so you can see that sometimes that's part of the process. So mixed it up. It's gloss varnish, just a few drops of this speedball ink. And here you'll notice I put alignment marks on the bottom so we could get an idea of the spots in the cube that I want to see the skeletons kind of peeking through, right? So as I lay my wash down, I kind of have these spots that I want to keep ultra thin, and the other spots I can go a little heavier. And I did use my GW shade brush, which I'm proud of. I got it recently in a kit, and I think they're good. I think they're really good little utility wash brushes. So here we go, and right away, you can see with this gloss varnish, it is very translucent. And I knew I was on the right track. There is a trade-off, though, and the trade-off is going to be it's going to take multiple coats. Now, I went ahead and sped the video up, and I showed you just about all of the coats that I put on. There might have been one or two coats that were off-cam, maybe a few touch-ups, but for the most part, everything you're going to see in the video is pretty much what I put into it. You also notice that I'm laying it on a lot thicker around the edges of the cubes, and I'm trying to make sure that I feather out the areas where the skeleton needs to peek through in the center of each facing. So that was like the first layer. I let it dry. This is still drying, and I'm going to hit the top end of it. So this varnish really worked quite well. I was really happy with it. But like I said, it looked really, really thin. So I knew it was going to take many, many coats. I went ahead and used a hairdryer here to dry in between my coats, because otherwise it would have taken me 4 weeks in between all of the individual coats. So just a real quick hair drying on a cool setting for a few minutes, and you're in business. It gets a little tacky, and I'm ready for the next layer. So as you can see, again, I'm putting most of it on the corners, and then I'm kind of feathering it through the center edge, wiping off my brush, removing a little bit, really trying to make sure that it doesn't accumulate in those center viewing areas. And I think when you see the end product, that I achieved the result that I wanted. So it's okay here on the corners to let it pool up and accumulate. You don't normally do that with washing, but remember, this is going to be a clear varnish once it dries. Hair dryer again, this really is a lifesaver in a project like this. Hair dryers, believe it or not as cheap as they used to be. Now they're like, you know, $30 for a halfway decent hairbrush. Hair dryer. Ridiculous. So anyhow, this is about the third layer that we're working on. And I noticed that it still was not enough color, right? I was maintaining transparency, but I was really not getting the saturation that I wanted. Because truly, the saturation is going to give you that, hey, I'm like a big gelatin blob bouncing down the dungeon corridor, right? If it just is too thin, it's going to be like, oh, it's tinted plastic. And that's what your mind is going to say when it sees it. So, continuing to work on this, pretty much, this is the process, trying to get what's in your mind to match with what's happening in front of you. That's a really good example right there of me working around that center viewing spot. And now, there were some times where I would slightly drag the brush so as to get a little bit of pigment in there. Hair dryer again. And yeah. So, I mean, this seems repetitive. So I guess it's a good time to talk about promotions. For those of you that are new to the channel, thanks for joining me. And for all of you that have been leaving comments on my painting videos and whatnot, and my gameplays, I really appreciate it. It really makes my day. I love watching you guys interact. And anytime I hear that someone's, you know, just picked up the hobby, or they're back into it after not being into it for a while because of my videos, man, I'm telling you, puts almost a perma smile on my face. It's all day long. It is the bomb. So, you know, keep interacting. I do enjoy it. If you haven't subscribed by now, what are you waiting for, dude? Subscribe. So you can see here, we're working on the inner piece. Enough of the promo, and we're doing yellow again. Nothing new here, except we are using a varnish this time. So, and I used a bit more of the yellow ink, because obviously yellow is traditionally a difficult color to get some opacity. So again, just laying this all over. We're going to make sure we get behind the objects, or on the inside. So we're painting it front and back. the stuff was really thin. It was just kind of running all over on me. And initially when I was doing it, I'm like, I don't know how this is going to work out. But believe it or not, once it all dried, it did look pretty good. Plus, there was the advantage of knowing it was going to be internal to the cube. And there you can see kind of how it's poking through. So here, right here, Minwax, polycrylic, high gloss, varnish. I watched some videos. This is the next day after all that work. And I wasn't getting enough gloss. So I heard some really good stuff about this. I went down to my local hardware store. And I'm telling you, this stuff is phenomenal. It is a dream. It can go on thick and it dries clear. I had no problem pigmenting it with some ink. And I just went through and I started coating it on. And you can see, I didn't even pigment it in this layer. It was straight varnish. It goes on kind of looking white, just like you see in the tin or the jar. And you know, it makes you a little worried when it's thick, but don't worry, it'll dry clear silk. Here's how you clean it out when you're done, so that way you can get the lid off later, the next time you decide to use it. And I went ahead and let that dry overnight, and it looked really good. I was really happy with it. Now here's the centerpiece. I needed to get in there and start painting some details. There's a lot of skeletal bones, some skeletons that have been sucked up by the gelatinous cube. So we're going to go in and paint it with, what do we use? Some crushed skull from the Army Painter War Paint line. And not really worrying too much about how accurate we're being, because remember, it's going to be inside the cube. So we painted everything with this standard bone color. There was also a shield and a few swords. But overall, you know, in terms of like how difficult this was to do, once you figure out getting the acrylic varnish to look the way you want it, that was the hardest part. So yeah, we use this P3 pig iron for the metal parts. Honestly, you could really grab any darkened metallic that you have. I didn't want to use something that was too shiny. I wanted it to kind of look a little old and a little maybe weathered, but I didn't really go too far with it. I just painted it this metal color, and later on we'll do a wash, maybe actually a couple washes, just for pretty much out of habit. Anytime you're painting, you know, it seems pretty hard not to throw a wash on top of what you've painted. And we even did a small highlight, I believe, off camera. But not too much. Like I said, this is going to be behind that clear gloss look that you saw. So here it is. You can see that the items are poking through in the viewing areas. I got a really good gloss going because of that Minwax. And I kind of wasn't really happy with the yellow. It kind of got lost into the green. You know, they are complementary colors. So I decided to grab a really dark green ink. And, I mean, because what makes more sense but inside of the cube, it to be a darker green than it was and then what it is on the exterior. Now, there was the risk of it being way too green, but I went ahead and took a look at it real quick. I said, yeah, I think I'm digging that. Now, that's, you see something dark while you're holding the cube, and then you get this three-dimensional thing and you're like, oh, what's in there? And no matter what, you can't help it. You look closer and then you start to see the details and you're like, oh, totally cool. Skeletons and weapons have been sucked up inside this thing, past combatants of the gelatinous cube. I mean, totally amazing. So the yellow didn't do that for me. So this dark green did. And you can see this Minwax, we went ahead and threw it in there. And this is the final product. And I'm really, really happy the way that turned out. Spent probably a lot more time on it than I wanted to, but you know, hey, making a video. So the Minwax was a really good life lesson. It's an amazing gloss varnish. I will use it on pretty much anything I want to get super shiny and sticky and wet looking, it was perfecto. And I think it was a tiny little bottle, 8 ounce thing. I paid like, I don't know, $8 or $9 for it. But that's like $1 per ounce. You don't get that in the hobby, right? So, yeah, I mean, this is going to spin for a bit. But again, I mean, it was a little bit, see how bright it is? That's kind of the lights. It really wasn't that luminescent. It is if you hold it in a certain light, but the way it looked in the beginning and when my hand was over, it was a little bit more realistic. But with the right lighting, and then I'll tell you that if you stuck it into a display case and put some good lights on it, this thing would definitely get a magical glow. Very, very happy with this. Definitely worth the money. It was a blast to paint. It was super easy. Just, I had one little snafu that I had to show you. But, you know, every project you're going to learn something, and that was what I learned with this one. So I'm going to take that and carry that information forth for the next time I try to do anything that's transparent. And these fabulous Nolzur's miniatures have a lot of transparent miniatures with giving you like magical and energy effects. So we're definitely going to utilize this going forward with some of the future projects that we're doing. And I literally have a humongous box of these things. At least 100, 125 different figures. I'm trying to focus on the monsters because I want to build up some minions. And yeah. So hey guys, I hope you enjoyed this. It was a lot of fun. For those of you subscribed recently and have been long-time subscribers, thank you very much. I do appreciate it. If you have not subscribed, dude, subscribe. Do it now. Hey, and also make sure to hit that bell. So that way, when I do decide to put out a video, sorry for the Christmas break and the long hiatus, but we're back at it now. Back on a regular schedule. But you got to hit that bell so you can get email notifications or, you know, notifications in your smartphone or however you do your Google stuff. And you can say, oh, you know, Scott put out a video. Another killer mini heading my way. And got some gameplays. I got all kinds of games that came in over the holidays. And matter of fact, got one in today that the box is so huge, it's actually bigger than Kingdom Death Monster. And I was like, where am I going to put this? So, not sure if we'll do a gameplay of that one because it's a multiplayer game. But again, guys, all sorts of love for you. I do appreciate all of the comments and attention and thumbs up. If you like, make sure you subscribe. Make sure you share with your friends. Let people know I exist. Doing videos, trying to paint some stuff up. If you are working on your RPGs, we're going to get into some board game minis here soon as well. I'm going to kind of go back and forth. And because it's, I'm a bit of a mayfly. And yeah. So that's how we're going to do it this time. So until next time, guys, you guys stay peaceful, stay cool, and above all, like, you know, just get along and enjoy. This last few months, I've seen a lot of really stressed out people. So hopefully you got some cool stuff to paint over the holidays, and now you're staring at all this stuff, wondering how you're going to do it. But, you know, I'm doing the same thing. So let's do it together. Whether you listen while you paint or you're learning, you can pause the video, get the equipment, get the paints, come back, paint later at a later date. It's however you want to do it. It's here for you. This is how I share to the community and to other new painters. That's what I target. So, till next time, guys. I hope all of your paint does not dry on your brush. You do not spill your ink. You make awesome highlights and butt shades. Killer minis. Double pieces. On the way out. Peace.